Yeah, thanks a lot for the invitation. To my understanding, I will give this presentation in English. Later on, you are invited to ask any questions. You may ask them in English or in German, so it's up to you. May I ask again, is there anyone who is already a bachelor student? Okay, so we have a good mix of both groups, very nice. So today I would like to introduce the climate problem as such with a couple of slides that we understand a little bit why we have introduced a new master's on climate. Then I want to talk also a little bit about the cluster of excellence on climate. We are here in a special location in Hamburg. We are the only location in Germany that runs a cluster of excellence on climate in this excellence initiative of the federal government and also the counties. And then, of course, I will describe our master's program so that you have an idea how you would study with us and how you get into this program and what the benefits are, of course. Now, this is one of the icons of the latest IPCC report. What is IPCC? The Intergovernmental Panel on Climatic Change. The climate topic is the only topic in the history of academia where the UN has purchased a series of reports. The UN thought the climate issue, global warming, is so important that they need a report every 5 to 7 years so that not individual professors or institutes give their statements, which are often a bit to the extreme, just to be more visible in the media, but rather to have a balanced view, to have an integrated view of what we do know and where the gaps of knowledge are. So one of the icons is the following graph. So if you look to the upper left corner of this figure, so what we see here are the global emissions over the last 250 years. And you can see a superlinear increase in emissions. Yeah? So they increase and the increase is accelerating. So this is intimately tied to economic growth worldwide, to the use of fossil fuels that drive economic growth to a certain extent. And this figure does also tell us who is emitting. What are the groups of countries who emit? And the OECD, where Germany belongs to the group that has started emitting CO2. But these days, the OECD is almost stabilizing, whereas Asia is now catching up, and the superlinear increase in emissions and global emissions is driven by Asian countries. This is understandable because up to date, economic growth is intimately tied to the use of fossil fuels such as coal, oil, and gas. Here we can see the accumulative amount of emissions. Yeah, from 1750 to 1970, we have a certain unit, and we have doubled this amount by today. So since 1970, a lot has happened. So this is in the nature of superlinear increase, that it's accelerating over and over, and so you have shorter and shorter time horizons to get the same amount of cumulative emissions. Now, what does it matter at all? These carbon dioxide emissions are accumulating in our atmosphere, and nature would recycle roughly half of them, and the other half is accumulating further. And this is important because carbon dioxide, the invisible gas that we all exhale, is a so-called greenhouse gas. So sun is shining on Earth, and for the visible light, the layer of carbon dioxide is transparent, but it's not so transparent for the infrared radiation that is then generated from the visible light and what that would need to go back to outer space to close the energy balance. So if you put up a thicker layer of carbon dioxide, it's like in a greenhouse, it gets warmer. Yeah, you need a higher temperature to get more energy out through the thicker layer. So this is the reason why we witness an increase in the so-called global mean temperature. This is an academic quantity, a very abstract entity. It's a mean across land and the oceans, but all the continents and about all the time horizons. So about night and day, about the seasons, and so it's a very aggregate quantity. And this might increase due to the increase of the concentration of this greenhouse gas. Now, why do we care about global mean temperature rise? Climate models tell us that an increase in global mean temperature does correlate with larger and or more frequent impacts in terms of extreme weather events. And in order to get an idea what are the exact consequences of CO2 emissions, carbon dioxide emissions, we need so-called climate models, or some call these type of enriched climate models already Earth system models. So you couple the atmosphere, the oceans, land surfaces, and the cryosphere into an interacting system, and humankind is embedded in it, but it's embedded in two ways. Yeah? So it's a victim of this dynamics, but also an actor. It is producing carbon dioxide, and this will cause something. Now, the IPCC, and this is another icon that was produced by the latest report in 2013. This graph displays what are the consequences of different climate policies. A so-called business as usual scenario means we don't have a mitigation policy, a policy that tries to mitigate further global warming. And then this would be one of these red scenarios here. Climate researchers have categorized these numerical experiments according to these numbers here. These are radiative forcing in watts per square meter at the end of the century. You don't need to memorize this. What you need to memorize is that the 8.5 is a scenario like we are on at the moment, that economic growth is basically tied to the use of fossil fuels, whereas the blue scenario is one which tries to stabilize global mean temperature at this regime here somewhere. And in between, this is the level of maneuvering that we do have as humankind. So it's also, to a certain extent, your decision in the future which of these scenarios comes through. Yeah? And this is now the debate. So what kind of future do we want? What is dangerous? What does it cost to mitigate? What does it cost to adapt to global warming, or is it a problem at all? And I want to explain a little bit the arguments, and I give this little overview on the global discussion on climate to give a better understanding why such a cluster of excellence here in Hamburg is a unique entity. Now, on the one hand, climate models and impact models do project these kind of phenomena. So the statistical statements are quite clear. There is a correlation. We cannot exactly predict where what will happen, but statistical properties can be projected to a certain extent these days. And the suite of unwanted, undesirable effects is the core reason why we care about global warming at all. So one category of impacts is of a different kind. Of course, if it gets warmer, it is a little bit as if Hamburg went down to Spain, yeah, in 100 years or so. With moderate global warming, no climate policy, we would just migrate down on the globe towards the equator, or vice versa. If you were an animal or a plant species, you would have to get more to the pole to get that climate you are adapted to. And the question is now, if we have an acceleration of global warming, will ecosystems be able to cope with this? Can they get fast enough more to the polar regions in order to survive? And these are the velocities that can be attached to certain species. These are the velocities that are exerted by the different scenarios from the blue to the red. And then they distinguish between flat areas and not so flat areas. Yeah, so if the area is flat, you have a faster effect, and on the other hand, you wouldn't. And you can see that some species are quite fast, they can cope with it, and others might not be able to cope with it. So the vulnerability of ecosystems is at the core of the discussion. To what extent is global warming dangerous at all? So we can project certain kinds of impacts, others we are not so good at. And this is where the precautionary principle comes into action. The European Commission has committed itself to in 2000 and 2001. And how could we operationalize a precautionary idea if we say we cannot predict everything? Yeah, the climate system, the whole world is so complicated, we cannot dare to be able to predict all the consequences of a warmer world. And so can we also bring in some precautionary idea? And this is one way of doing so. So you can look at the same graph and try to get an idea what is a large change in temperature at all, what is a proper scale to compare global warming that is induced by human action, by our economic activity too. And one scale of comparison that does make sense in my opinion is the temperature difference of the present climate that is called the Holocene, that has prevailed since the last 10,000 years, as against the last ice age. During the last ice age, Hamburg was covered with an iceberg. Yeah, you were in a completely different world. So this is a huge change. You are in a different world if you go from an ice age to a warm age, and now maybe even to a hothouse. So the last ice age was characterized by temperature, global mean temperature change against the standard climate, the Holocene, in terms of 5 degrees Celsius. 5 degrees Celsius is a large change. You are in a different geological epoch. Now, if we flip from here to there, where we are now, to the so-called hothouse, we might be in a climate that we haven't witnessed for roughly 50 million years. 50 million years is a very long time horizon. Our civilization was not there, our species was even not there, and even the continents were not in place. So it's a completely different situation. And to me, it is hard to imagine that we could be able to predict how life would be under such conditions. So this is one of the reasons why the European Commission finally subscribed to the so-called 2-degree target. It's drawing a line between the red and the black situation, yeah, and the green is closer to the black than to the red. So it is not a small change, yeah, if you compare it to this distance. It might be 30% of the total change, but nevertheless, you are closer to a regime you do know, you are adapted to. So the 2-degree target is an amalgamate out of 3 arguments. A precautionary argument, you also do know a couple of impacts you want to avoid, and then the need for simplification in the climate negotiation process. A single number in terms of temperature is something you can communicate, and then actors can discuss whether they want to go for this or not. Now, what can we do as a society? Now we get from the geophysical machinery to the impact discussion, some debate about ethics, indirectly in a sense. Yeah, we were discussing impacts, undesirable impacts, and also precautionary arguments. And now the question is, what are the tools at our disposal? Now, if we break down this complicated system into just 2 actors, the socio-economic system and the climate system, a very primitive approach, of course, then mitigation is at the core of the problem. Yeah? We just stop or reduce emissions. On the other hand, we will always see some residual global warming because the ocean is moderating global warming, and it would be 0.6 degrees Celsius warmer if we had a thought experiment in just freezing the concentration of greenhouse gases today. So it's colder than it should be. So we will see additional warming even if we stabilize the concentration of greenhouse gases. Furthermore, we see that global climate policy is not in line with the 2-degree policy. We are more on a path that is on the red end of the scale I've displayed to you between blue and red. So it might be useful to talk about adaptation as well, building higher dikes, for example. One of the big floods in Hamburg was avoided in terms of damages last December, not this December, but in 2013, because we have higher dikes. Yeah, Hamburg has adapted to these situations. Disaster like in the 60s did not occur, although the natural science drive was much stronger than in the 60s. So adaptation is a powerful tool, and it's also a matter of economics to discuss with citizens what mixture of mitigation and adaptation might be useful. So a last word on mitigation, a key statement by the IPCC this April, so the last April 2014, was that indeed the 2-degree target could be achieved at rather modest cost. So we could have, if we had an ideal cooperative situation globally and a coordinated way to incentivize low carbon technologies and also efficiency increase, the change in lifestyle is not at the forefront in this discussion necessarily. So we could go on, we could solve the climate problem basically with technical means if we wanted to do so. We can have continued economic growth during this century and compliance with the 2-degree target. So we are not in a tragic choice. And we will see a little reduction in the growth rate. So the reduction in growth rate is smaller by a factor 20 to 50 than the growth rate itself, if everything is properly done. Now, of course, we are experimenting with mitigation technologies, renewables, efficiency increase, and so on, through all the world, and it's costly if you don't have the right incentives in place. So this is in part now one of the jobs of economics to advise, to assess scenarios of policy interventions, how you could drive down the costs of a certain climate target. Now we come to the cluster of excellence. So the cluster of excellence here in Hamburg is sort of mimicking the historic development that the discussion about climate has done or has gone through. So at the kernel, there's a long-standing tradition in Hamburg in geophysical modeling, atmosphere modeling, ocean modeling, coupling of the two, then integrating land surfaces who are subject to global warming, but also act back to the climate system by exhaling carbon dioxide or methane and other greenhouse gases. So this is sort of the geophysical kernel of the project. So the excellence cluster is a long-term project. And this is about expressions of climate in different regions and certain themes. So does the Arctic sea ice survive? Yeah, so certain aspects of climate and global warming, so the impact of global warming on climate subsystems is investigated here. Sea level rise is also an important subject, so it has a global component but also regional expressions. And then this is, in a sense, an ambitious extension of the climate discussion towards society. We have a couple of departments here in our university that are excellent to link the geophysical discussion to what society needs. Yeah? So the geophysical discussion as such has not had a big impact on society so far. And now actors are understanding they do need to understand better what are the social dynamics, how, for example, is the climate problem perceived in the media, how is it transported, how is climate information conveyed in the society. Some people do know better about certain subjects than others, and they can use this information to get a personal advantage from it. And also a unique aspect here in Hamburg is the following, that we have a long-standing tradition in security research, and to my gut feeling, and this is not an academic statement, it's a gut statement if you like, the climate problem is first of all a security issue and only indirectly an economic one, if you talk about the impacts of global warming, so that certain societies might get destabilized by global warming, and then this might cause international turmoil and then later economic effects. So starting from this geophysical kernel that is decades old in Hamburg, now more and more departments are collaborating about the climate issue, and this is what such an excellence cluster is about. So a university gets 20 to 30 million euro for a couple of years, for 5 years. Now we got it for the second time. And in order to orient more and more researchers to a joint subject. So this is a very exciting development. And then also a school was founded in this vein. Now I just want to highlight two aspects to give you a flavor of what we do in this excellence cluster. So it's a research focus. So this is not only about the university actually, but also about other partners who do a lot of excellent work on climate. So the Max Planck Institute for Meteorology, which got famous in the 90s for putting up a statistical test whether the observed global warming could be explained as a natural fluctuation. So this brought Hamburg to the frontier as a climate research location. And Helmholtz-Zentrum Gestach is also with us, and also DKRZ. Now, this is one graph that was produced by CLISAP collaborators here in Hamburg and other institutions outside Hamburg. And that shows the differentiation in sea level rise. Sea level does rise under global warming because simply water does expand if it gets warmer. So you have a growing elevated sea level. IPCC report comes to the conclusion it's between 0.5 and 1 meter, depending on our policy measures during the century. By the end of the century, but this is not uniform, but you have differentiations. For example, because land ice does attract water masses, and if the land ice goes down, you have a going down of drop back of the sea level. This is what many people don't know. It's an effect only discovered in the 19th century. Well, overall you have an increase, but in some regions you have this is superimposed by decrease of sea level. So here in Hamburg, the data of these projects are stored, they are sort of assembled and harmonized. So this shows that Hamburg is really in many communities that are related to climate research at a focus. This is an ongoing project. There are individual results, but not an overall result yet. So one of the most ambitious integrated projects within CLISAP. So here the question is, can we make use of the fact we have a security research group? Can we make use of the fact that we have, on the other hand, leading research groups on the changes in precipitation patterns? Rain is very important for agriculture. If the location of rain is changing under global warming, and these are major scenarios for East Asia. that in principle billions of people can get under risk under global warming. The agricultural system might undergo dramatic changes. And it's then, of course, a question how flexible is that agricultural system. But first of all, there is a problem, so that we can model really this whole impact chain, yeah, from precipitation changes to agricultural yield changes in certain regions. And we go into the regions, we zoom into the regions that seem most vulnerable according to our climate models. And then it goes into water, food security issues, and then in general security issues. Yeah. So we really integrate here the research group on conflict down to the geophysical effects. Now this is an ambitious sub-project, and we will see how far we get. In the end, it is about the question: to what extent can you handle global warming by adaptation? And what are more concrete reasons for mitigation? Yeah? Are there some, apart from these precautionary ideas that I illustrated from this 50 million year horizon argument, but are there more concrete reasons that you can pin down? So these are just two examples out of a whole wealth of sub-projects within CLISAP. Now I really get into the description of the school. And I talked about climate, the climate problem, and also CLISAP, because this school is special in the sense that it is founded by the Excellence Cluster. It is a school where you should learn in the most efficient way those relations and foundations such that you can enter the research process as fast as possible, that you get into the real thing as fast as possible. So, in that sense, here we integrate all relevant climate sub-branches. And in that sense, to really guide it close with the research of an excellence cluster, it may serve as a role model for other research questions. So it is, in that sense, multidisciplinary. So we come from atmosphere, ocean, and also include social science. We bring early on students and scientists together, models and observation. In that sense, we strengthen the interdisciplinary tradition here in the Klima Campus Hamburg. Klima Campus is an ensemble of different institutions that do work on climate, at least in part. So to have a joint knowledge base, in a sense. Also, we run a joint colloquium that invites brilliant people with presentations that are, on the one hand, tackling burning issues, on the other hand, should be accessible to non-specialists. Also, you should go there. Yeah? These are really presentations, most of them you could follow, I think. You could get already the main ideas what's going on in the international discussion. And yes, in the end, so this is also an ambition aspect, you should have a mind map that guides you through the discussion with policymakers, so that you don't only think in terms of equations, but have some flavor of, got some flavor of what's really going on in the world. What do you need? A solid background in mathematics and physics. In the formalities, I produced some slides. You can download them later. I won't read them here. It's a two-year curriculum. I will describe in detail in a second. And we offer three climate science tracks. So one is the physical one. Then one is focusing on biogeochemistry. And the last one that I'm heading is about economics and social sciences, insofar as they relate to climate. And this is the overview slide on the whole program. And the important aspect for you, the most important aspect, is the division of labor between the green and the blue parts. The green are compulsory courses. These are courses in these boxes, and I will show you in a second which these are, which you have to take. Yeah, there is no choice. In the blue ones, you do have a choice. And this is now the crucial aspect. In the beginning, we ask you to learn about all three tracks. Yeah, this is more a general education. These are introductory courses. And then early on, already in the second term or second semester, you have a lot of choices. So you can find out what suits you best, and you design by yourself your personal curriculum out of these, under advice, if you wish so. And then in the third term, we offer a climate study project. Here you enter a research group and would work in a targeted way through the literature, also attend standard lectures and seminars, but they should be correlated to what you need here. And so you have a seamless transition from a general education over a sort of a test phase where you can co-design with us your personal curriculum, then into a research environment. And then here, of course, in the fourth term, the master's thesis as such is produced. Now, there are some, in the first term, we have some general skills we offer to you. Then some courses that are mandatory about the first two tracks and some courses on climate and society. And here you have choices. So here, so the number of choices here are not so large as the graph has already emphasized before. In the second term, there are a few mandatory courses from geophysics. So you can still see here the CLISAP project and the whole school is coming from a geophysical tradition. But there are only three courses now, just for orientation. The next slide will be about this huge box here. And these are a huge number of courses you can choose from. And you have a lot of freedom here. You need 18 credit points altogether from this box. And the only boundary condition we put up for you is that at maximum you are allowed to take 9 per track. So you cannot only focus on one track, but in principle, 9 plus 9, you could decide you go only for the blue and the green ones and you avoid the red if you don't want to have courses with economics or social sciences, or vice versa. Yeah. On the other hand, you can go for the broadest mix. You can also divide 18 by 3. You take 6 credit points from each of the tracks. So this is the other extreme. So it's up to you. You can go for your own choices here. You can design your own curriculum. And then there are some technical skills. They are optional. You might take them or not. If you think you need them, you can take them, but it's not mandatory. Then in the third term, you go for this so-called study project. So this is this intense literature research under the auspices of a real research group. And then 9 credit points, so 30 credit points is the number you need per term, per semester. Then 9 are still needed from standard lectures and seminars. Here you have huge choices and absolutely no restrictions. It's absolutely up to you what you choose. So the degree of freedom is increased dramatically from term to term. So, and this is a degree of freedom where you can fine-tune between geophysics over biogeochemistry to social science. We believe that this degree of freedom is quite unique in that respect. Then, of course, in the fourth semester, you write your master thesis. And generally, so if it's well-functioning, if you are in a group, are properly supervised, you are doing a good job, then generically you already produce your first article with your name on it. If you have done it in a very good manner, then you are first. Yeah. If you have helped a little bit, you are already on the paper, that's also very good. This is not a matter of course at all, that already in the phase of your personal education, you can write a paper. So the paper is the currency where the academic reputation is paid by, in a sense. Yeah, this is where your thoughts are then public and are immortal, in a sense. So this is why publications are key in the whole academic system in your academic vita. And then it's a good test for you. You can check whether you like being a researcher or not. Yeah, if you then want to leave academia, want to go to other branches of life, or whether you want to go on with a PhD project. Now, what are typical topics of these master theses? Now, we assembled the titles of a couple of study projects. So this is from the class that started in 2011. We picked this class because here we had the best balance of the three tracks. Just for illustration, so this is about the Atlantic, Meridional Ocean Circulation. Another North Atlantic topic, precipitation in a city. So this is already a topic that is at the borderline between social systems and geosciences, but runs here clearly under meteorology, and so on and so forth. So this is on the physics track. This is now about biogeochemistry. It's about permafrost. So first of all, get an understanding of how this system works. It's very important under the discussion of global warming because a lot of methane is stored in the permafrost layer. And if you have global warming, methane may emanate from the permafrost system to the atmosphere. And methane is a very powerful greenhouse gas. Other topics can be read here. And that class, the economic and social science track, was extremely strong. I dared to pick a thesis that I have supervised on my own. Maja Stankowicz's thesis was about the question, to what extent so-called climate engineering is an attractive option if you also consider side effects or potential side effects. Climate engineering in its most risky manner, by either dimming the sun, putting up mirrors in space, or doping the stratosphere with sulfur, for example, by doping the fuel of airplanes that go into the stratosphere, and then you have a sort of artificial cloud or aerosols in these layers, and you have an increased amount of reflection of light. So this is the engineering idea for a society that does not mitigate early enough for one or the other reason. And why we have such a slow process in global treaty negotiations, you might have followed these processes that go on since the 90s. There are mixed opinions about this, but this is a major research question in our excellence cluster. Why is it so slow? Is it what people really want in the end? Don't they want mitigation in the end? Is it what we need, but we are not willing to talk about it? Or do we have frictions in the system we can overcome with adequate instruments that are academically designed? Now, a key result from this master thesis that will now result in a paper, or at least one paper, is that you can save almost totally the mitigation costs because these sulfur techniques are very cheap. So this is what we knew before. But this thesis shows if you take the potential impact seriously and put up a scale of sensitivity to this impact that is sort of in line with what a person that supports the 2-degree target would accept. It is about changes in precipitation patterns that are induced by climate engineering. Climate engineering can cool the planet, but as a side effect, you have changes in some precipitation patterns. So if you want to limit these changes, you can only reduce the cost by a third, not by 100% anymore, almost 100%, as it was promised before. So this option, climate engineering, is then by far less attractive. So the risks of climate engineering is something you really have to look into if you want an integrated assessment of this technology. Okay, so this thesis bridged natural science aspects. So Marius built modules that absorb key findings of natural scientists, put these items into an economic model and ran an integrated assessment with the economic model. Now, how large are we? We are small compared to other programs. We are quite young. The Excellence Cluster started in 2007, and in the years later, also the school started, so there are only a couple of years that it's running. In the end, on the order of 20 are admitted, and some fewer then would start. Then we have a quite fair gender distribution here. And where do our master students end up? Some of them continue a PhD. Others go to other institutions, for example, in agencies, NGOs, consultancies. So these are generic paths that we find. Unfortunately, about some of them we don't know, and we want to invest more to find out how the career paths look like later on. Now, we also are quite international. Roughly a third is German, half of the students is non-EU, coming from non-EU countries. And many are absorbed by then the co-designed doctoral program, the sixth doctoral program. What does this doctoral program offer? The same statements hold in terms of interdisciplinarity here as well. Such a program has the advantage as against a traditional PhD where you are basically alone with your supervisor that you have an advisory panel system. So you have two meetings per year that are mandatory. And there are three pairs of eyes that watch your thesis, not only one. And this increases the incentive to be successful and to be on time a lot. And experience has shown at the University of Hamburg that these panel system, on average, really accelerate the thesis. So that you are, the chance that you are, have got your PhD after 3 or 4 years are significantly higher under such a panel system. You have further courses offered. You have only 12 CPs as mandatory. So there are technical and research skills that you can further train here. There are further activities. So there's an annual retreat. There are basically an exchange is organized between the doctoral candidates, their excursions, and so on. And there's also financial support for additional research activities such as conferences or summer schools. So there's a pool of money that can be useful if you have extra wishes. So this is coming with this concept of a school. Desire is that you submit your thesis after 3 years. If this cannot work, materialize, there are ways to extend such a system, but the pressure is high to really come to an end after 3 years. And we have to be quite frank. If you think you want more liberty, you want more time, then such a school system is not the right format for you. So this is this has to be discussed, of course, in advance. This is how the research topics are distributed. So these are the more geophysics-oriented subjects, but there are many other subjects in this pie chart here. And the duration of thesis is between 3 and 4 years. Now, this is our team. So we have three heads. We have a rotation system. At the moment, I'm the overall head, and the others are the track leaders. So any of us is leading one of the three tracks. And we are rotating every year or every 1.5 years. And we have a powerful SIX office with different functions. And please contact them for a specific question. Jennifer Fix is here to help you with the master program. Berit Hachfeld is for the PhD program. And Eike Deppeckmann is about academic affairs. So for example, questions about the curriculum or also how to prepare for exams, what are the exact conditions to go for exams. Just for your record, if you download these slides later, how to contact these people and how to find them. And I also assembled a couple of admission rules. I will not read them here. So basically, you need a strong background in mathematics or physics in terms of 90 credit points. And you need a bachelor in one of the above mentioned fields here. So these are the general rules. If you're brilliant and you come from a different field, we may talk about it, but this is in general what we expect. And of course, you have to prove you are able to follow the discussions in English and participate in the discussions. This is your application period. It's 6 weeks from, roughly 6 weeks from February, mid-February to March, and this is what you need. These are the documents, so please have a look at it if you're interested. Now, I want to come to an end to give space for your questions. If I had to summarize why you might or why you should start with SIX, with us. So what do I find really attractive? I were a student again. Yeah? If I could turn back time and if I had the same offer, what would I find attractive? Now, number one is it's one of the few climate programs worldwide. Climate is one of the issues in this century. Yeah? So many world-leading organizations have stated this clearly, not only the UN, but also the World Bank and other bodies. And so if you have some knowledge about this, this might be useful, either spiritually, because you are at the core of what's going on in this century, or also in terms of career. Yeah? If you do know about one of the most important subjects of the century. Then next, you are close to excellent research. This is not only education. This is education that is coupled with research. It is driven by research. It is optimized for being able to be at the frontier of research rather fast. So if you are interested in research, it's good. If you want a more silent kind of education and an easy master, it might not be the right thing for you. You can tailor your curriculum, as I emphasize it. You can fine-tune the mix between these three branches here. And coming with this is another aspect. You can fine-tune whether you want to go for depth. You want to understand exactly how the ocean functions. Yeah, you want to learn everything about hydrodynamics of the ocean. Or you go more for the overview character. You want to understand the key aspects of most of these fields, that you then have a big mind map. And in many careers, this is of utmost importance. And it's not easy to find bodies that transfer this knowledge to you. So you can fine-tune to what extent you want the one or the other. And then in the end, we also offer an excellent supervision ratio. So the number of lecturers per student is rather large. So you're working here in groups in terms of 4, 5 to 12 to 15, but not of 30 usually. Yeah. So you really can come into contact with the lecturers, ask questions, ask again. You are not simply a number, you are a person. You are treated as an individual. Also by the staff members, it's a larger office, so they can take time to deal with special effects that may pop up in your personal career. Okay, so these are some pictures illuminating some of the functions you might be involved in if you enroll with SIX. And this is just a photo taken by Alexander Gerst. He's also from Klima Campus Hamburg, did his PhD with Matthias Hort, who is leading one of the three tracks. So this is watching the Earth from space, and it's getting an overview from a very special perspective. So this is what we offer in SIX. Thanks a lot. Yes, in a very reduced manner, an economic model would do so. Yeah, this is one aspect. There are more and more models that try to project how parts of society react to shortnesses in food and other things. So these models that try to predict conflicts. About social science, I don't know personally so well about, but about economics, I can certainly say that there are different perspectives that are scanned in our excellence cluster. So you have a perspective from a company. How would a company react to certain incentive schemes like the European cap and trade system? On the other hand, how would a national economy respond to certain targets, environmental targets? What are the economic losses? And I personally expect that these economics models will in the future also incorporate effects like life quality, so that you go beyond gross domestic product, GDP, that needs to grow all the time according to the current ideology. According to our history, actually, GDP has grown in the OECD for hundreds of years. So it's a very robust phenomenon, and to change this, to call for post-growth society, is a dramatic change. It is something, it's a structural break, and we don't know, we don't understand the mechanisms of economic growth very well yet. So these models have a very crude set of assumptions. I find them not completely meaningless, I have to say. I'm using them myself. And they assume that a society is optimizing as a whole for a longer time horizon. So you can interpret what's going on in a society through this lens. And then you can ask, if you now put up a climate policy, like a 2-degree target, how much would it cost in terms of consumption losses? And since we are just in a lucky situation that renewable energy is abundant, so you might know that a square of 40 by 40 kilometers in the Sahara could feed the electricity demand by Europe. Yeah, it's a small square compared to the whole area of Europe. So in principle, from a physical point of view, this is possible. And now the new aspect of the latest IPCC report was that it's also possible economically, that we can continue economic growth. We just need to switch, just in quotation marks, but we just have to switch the technology by which we generate primary energy. And we have done this in the past already. Yeah, we switched from coal to oil to gas, and before we had even wood. So we know how to do this. Yeah, so this is the hope that with the proper incentive schemes, this could be done if people want it. And this is also part of the research that's going on here to zoom into the society. So who does want what, and who does communicate what to whom? Many people, for example, don't understand that a climate policy is basically devaluing the value of the fossil resources dramatically. The owners of fossil resources are expecting a lot of rents from their coal fields or oil fields. Now, if you are not allowed to burn these anymore, of course the value has gone down. And this, of course, causes certain actions. So I think it's important for an educated society that a majority of people does understand where the conflict lines are. I again want to encourage you to contact us, and I thank you for your attention.